60 feet, okay, unless you down.
Good evening. It is right around 7 o'clock on Monday, the 21st of March. This is a regular meeting of the Richfield Board of Education. In attendance this evening are Tim Paulus and Crystal Brocky, Superintendent Stephen Owski, John Ashmead, Christine Malik, Paula Cole. Our student representatives, Shay Walters and Catherine Zolmer, and I'm Peter Tensing. So welcome everybody. I want to call your attention to that top of our agenda where we are focusing ourselves on the mission of Richfield Public Schools to inspire and empower each individual to learn, grow, and excel. I just always like to get myself kind of focused in on that mission as just a reminder of what we're all about here. I would look to the board for review and approval of the agenda. Or any questions on the agenda, if there are any.
Can we clarify that everyone got the updated agenda?
So the item that was updated is relative to the, Beth, I think you said the update item is relative to the achievement integration budget?
That's correct. New business item E, achievement and integration budget.
Was there also additional information on the insurance?
Yeah, those background information.
So board members, if you haven't downloaded the updated form, it is on the website. So that you could log into the wireless and pull that in if you needed to. With those additions,
I move that we approve the updated agenda.
I'll second that.
Excellent. So motion by Malik, second by Ashmead. Is there any further discussion on the agenda? All in favor, please say aye.
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 Any opposed? The chair votes aye, the motion carries. So we'll move on to item three, which is receiving of delegations. We are honored to be joined this evening by Jason Sellers from RCEP and Mr. Unowski.
Yes, Mr. Sellers is our Director of Alternative Learning, and we're very excited to have him here today. He's going to be talking about one of our very innovative new programs that we are launching and a very exciting partnership. As we think about our RCEP students, they're students that have not traditionally succeeded in the traditional high school program, and so we are providing alternative learning for them. And what our partners, under the guidance of Jason and our leadership team, have done is created and prepared to launch a partnership with Normandale Community College for an early college option for our high school students. And so what he's going to be talking about is some of the details around co-locating or locating our RCEP program from our typical high school campus right here, moving them to Normandale, and he's going to talk about some of the things that make this particular program, which will allow our students to get both high school and college credits at the same time at an accelerated rate. He's going to tell us some of the things that make this particularly innovative and exciting as an opportunity for our kids. Please share, Jason.
School board members, Board Chair Tensing and Superintendent Unowski, I'm really excited to be here tonight. Tonight represents the culmination of a lot of work by a lot of people in Richfield Public Schools. A couple of the new board members came and toured our facility, met some of our kids, and saw what we were doing. But we really wanted to take things to the next level. And working with Normandale Community College and several key stakeholders there, we came up with an idea that we thought would not only take advantage of the new legislation by the state around the early middle college programming options that are available for high schools and middle schools, but also take advantage of a traditionally underserved population that doesn't actually have a true pathway to college at this point. Technically they do, but really in actual fact, they don't. So what you have before you in your board packet are the nuts and bolts of what we believe is gonna be a really great partnership. We're at this point calling it the Richfield Normandale Prep. It's gonna create a dual enrollment opportunity for students. So here's how it's different. In other school districts that neighbor us, they try to bring the college professors to the students in a facility much like what we're at right now. And that's not really working out so well because the college professors have to be on the school district schedule and the students are looking for more enrollment options than what they can provide in that one building. So in working with Normandale, there are only two or three other programs similar to this in the state. We decided immediately that the best option for our students who typically do not go to college And if they do, they are unsuccessful. We decided to locate it at Normandale. So what we're doing is we're taking the very best of who we are as a team, our staff, which is highly skilled in working with alternative students, providing out social and emotional support, but personalized academic support, in particular with the technology options that we use. Moving whole hog to Normandale, being in a home base center, and then having these kids, instead of being 18 or 19 and 2 and 2.5 years away from graduation, only working on their high school diploma, the goal was, if it's going to take them that long, then why don't we get them a college degree as well, or at least get them down the track for a college degree as well. So Richfield High School teachers that currently teach at RSEP, along with myself, will be housed in Normandale. The second piece is that they would be they would be dual enrolled. That's different from concurrent enrollment. So at the high school, when you have CIS courses, when you have courses that are taught by Richfield High School teachers that have been certified by the state to teach college courses, they take that here. Our students will be taking college courses from college professors on the Normandale campus. At the same time, they'll be taking high school courses for graduation with our teachers. So that's the difference between concurrent, which means students at a high school taking college courses, and dual, which is actually being a college student on campus. We believe that in the first year, we will have between 60 and 80 students. One of the things I'd like to point out is that enrollment for RSEP has been declining over the past couple of years, and we look around at other communities and see what kind of alternative options can we give our students that will attract not only our own students, but maybe students who haven't been served by other districts as well. RSEP has a population almost entirely of Hispanic students. We're about 98% Hispanic. And that's a population that is only realized in terms of enrollment at Normandale by about 6% of their total population. So immediately, between Normandale and our partnership, they increase the amount of underserved students that they'll actually be serving. When we looked at the mission and vision and we sat down and we talked about would this partnership be a reality, as Board Chair Tensing pointed out, we're talking about learning, growing, and excelling. If you look at Normandale Community College's mission, learning, that's the intellectual piece. Growing, that's the career piece. Personal development, that's excelling as individual students. So the mission and vision was the same. And then when we sat down and we compared strategic plan alignment, they lined up very, very well. College readiness, educational pathways, the same for us. Wanting to make sure that all students of varying life circumstances, meaning all students, not just students that are enrolled in the high school, but non-traditional students that have had a different path to their education. And so we realized right away that there was the opportunity for fertile ground in terms of a partnership. We came up with a core philosophy, and that core philosophy is that we believe that students who have desire and motivation to go to college can be served by this program. And that not only will they graduate high school, but they will also potentially graduate college if they are there for the entire duration. In your board packet, you can also see the different sort of focuses that we have. We believe that if we receive a student that's a junior and has about 25 credits, that they'll be able to earn anywhere from 20 to 30 college credits in the time it would take them to finish those credits with us at the high school. So be well on their way. So who are they? Who are the kids that are coming to us? Well, typically they are students that are age 16 to 21, they're off track from graduation, or they are not in school, and they enroll. I took two phone calls today from students and their families that wanted to enroll because they're off track, they realize they need to get back in school, and they want that opportunity. The second thing, and this is kind of important, we have a number of students in our community that are 18, 19 years old that have just dropped out. We had around almost 100 students that dropped out of the high school. We called each of those students and said, you know, we are thinking of providing programming in this area. Would this be something that would be interesting to you? And a lot of it is around motivation. I'm 18, I'm just going to work, I'll get my GED later, right? But now they have the opportunity where they don't feel like they've fallen behind their peers, because that's the reality. When you talk to our kids and they're 18 and 19 and they still have 15, 20 credits to go, they're like, this is just so hard, I'm just going to work, I'll get a car, I'll take care of my family, that sort of thing. But now they have the opportunity to get both at the same time, so they don't feel like they're behind their peers. So, what are we gonna provide? We're not gonna provide much different than we're providing now. And this is in the appendices of your PowerPoint, so I'm gonna stop after this. But what I would tell you is this. There is no program like this in the southern or western metro. This would be brand new. The second thing is that we believe that we'd be able to grow the program over the next 3 to 5 years, and that the sweet spot for this program would be 150 students. RSEP has never served that amount of students, but we know those students exist in our community, and they're looking for more options. The third piece, and this for me is really important, I talked about this at Normandale when I met with the president and the vice presidents, and it's around that generational poverty gap. We have kids that we serve at RSEP right now who have families that are stuck in that poverty gap. They're making $20,000 to $30,000 a year doing the jobs that are available to them. We have students that when they graduate RSEP are working the same jobs they were working before they graduated RSEP, right? And they're good, they're fine jobs. They're working at a rapid oil change, they're working as a server, they're working in the hospitality industry, but they don't have the option for upward mobility. Now, if they come to our new school, if they come to Richfield Normandale Prep, they have the opportunity not only to get their high school diploma, but once they get their high school diploma, they'll have the opportunity to complete a 2-year degree, a hospitality certificate, an IT license. So now they qualify for lower to middle level management, whereas before they wouldn't qualify for anything but the entry level position. And speaking to a couple of different business leaders and companies in the hospitality industry, bilingual candidates that have a high school degree and a hospitality certificate can earn north of $40,000 a year, somewhere between that 40 and 60 range. That's something for our kids that right now they have no realization of that. The other thing I'd like to do is I'd like to thank, we have 3 students that graduated RSEP before I got here, and that was due to the hard work of Cassie and the team at RSEP. All 3 students attended Normandale this fall. I didn't know who these kids were. They weren't on our rosters, but I would see them 2 or 3 times a week, and they'd be coming back to talk to our teachers. And I finally asked them, like, who are these kids? What's going on? Well, they're taking Normandale classes, but it's pretty hard for them, and they need some extra support. They were coming back and getting that support from the people they trusted, from the teachers that had the relationships with them. It didn't work out because it was just too much for them, but we're hoping that by being located there, by offering them that dual enrollment opportunity, they can not only break that poverty cycle for them and their families, but they can be the first in their family to go to college. We believe this is a really innovative and exciting option for kids, and we're really excited about it moving forward. And if you have questions, I'd have them.
So before jumping into questions, a couple of bullet points that I really want to highlight because they're the things that excite me the most and make this an option that I think has some real potential. Having dual enrollment options for students is across the entire metro, but what makes this particular brainchild of our teams unique is that we're talking about our staff, our counselor, our administrator, our teachers physically housed on the Normandale campus. So instead of sending our students off on a bus or in their cars off to a community college, we're actually going with them. So that if there are questions, if they need tutoring, if they need counseling, if they need support, our administrators, our counselors, our team is there to support them. And so while they're in classes with our high school teachers, they're learning high school curriculum, but then they go down the hall to the college class. And then they're able to come back for additional support, additional tutoring if needed, to ensure that they're able to gain all of those credits that they may not have gained in the traditional high school, and that without our additional supports, they might not be able to gain in the community college. That's what makes this particular program especially unique and especially exciting. And when he talks about this particular type doesn't exist, having high school teachers located on the campus of a community college is very rare, and we couldn't actually find examples of that out there that we were aware of.
So, more than rare, maybe groundbreaking, perhaps. Questions for Mr. Sellers or for the superintendent or board members?
I have a question. You mentioned approximately 70 students the first year and growing to 100 or maybe to 150. Is that based on students from our current population of students, or are you thinking this would attract students from outside our district?
Both. The true answer is that, you know, we do a really good job on our staff, and we feel very supported by administration and district leadership. However, the services that we can provide are limited in nature. This is sort of the next step. And so if you give students in Bloomington, students in Edina, students in Minneapolis, and Richfield students the opportunity to be college students, to live that schedule, to not be behind their peers. Our students are very excited about this. When you talk to them, they have all sorts of different ideas about where they want to go, who they want to be, and what they want to do. I know that that will appeal to other ALC students who are off track from graduation. And once the word gets out, and frankly, in our community, in the ALC community, it's a very tight, sort of close community, we kind of all know one another. When that word gets out, I know students will come, because it'll get out through the kids. You mean, I can be at Normandale on the campus, that's where I go every day for school. That's a big deal for our students, and that will attract, we believe, a lot of students. The reason why I give 150 as that number in my mind, because when I do the simple math around students, at that number, we can have a full-time staff, we can pay for everything we need to be, and we can generate revenue. And that would be the first time that I believe that.
The other piece connected to that, as we think about the number of students, if you look at the transition of the number of ninth graders to the number of 10th graders, there's a typical attrition rate of approximately 70 students across our district. And so as we think about where those students go, RCEP is one of those opportunities. And so if we just captured half of those 70 students every year to RCEP, that's 35. In 10th grade, 11th grade, and 12th grade, they'd be over 100 quite quickly. And so this has the opportunity to really blossom as an attraction to Richfield students. And as he said, also to be a pretty significant open enrollment option for other students to join us.
That connects to my question. First, I'm also really excited about this and just think it seems like an incredible opportunity for our students in Richfield and hopefully other students as well. So the first question, it sounds like you just answered, which is students from other communities would open enroll in Richfield to participate. My second question is whether, as part of this partnership, Normandale would refer students to us and to this partnership who are coming to them saying, you know, I want to go to Normandale, but I don't have my high school degree yet. Mm-hmm. It sounds like the answer is yes. So why don't you just speak to that?
So, you know, as you know, so that's kind of like, I have plan A, plan B, and plan C in recruiting. I call it recruiting because I think it's actively giving students an option they don't have. And I love that you asked that question because that's in some of the details. You know, one of the things that we have scheduled this spring is I'll be meeting with Torian, who is the dean of students, academic advising, and his team. They go out to high schools just like every other college students, and they have, okay, Normandale's here today if you want to stop by, or, you know, Bemidji State's here today, whatever the college is. My plan is to meet with those recruiters, those advisors, be able to give them information on this, because here's what's going on in our system now. When those people go to high schools, they say, okay, we're Normandale, we're probably not going to get the four-year kids. Do you have kids that are on the B honor roll? Let's see if we get those kids. Or if you're a four-year school like the U, you're going to come in and you're going to say, you know what, we're the U of M. Who are your top kids? We want to see who your top kids are. Nobody comes in and says, who are your kids that are struggling? Who are your kids that are behind? We have something for those kids. There's nobody going after that market. And that market is just for the kids. To me, I say market, but I know some of those kids. And in truth, we do have some kids that are open enrolled right now on our stuff. And so that's that market that we captured by really focusing clearly on 16 to 21 and off track graduation. I hope that answers the question.
Thank you.
I have a couple questions, and it's more like organizing things in my brain. I went to a community college, that's where I started, so I don't like when people say, oh, those are, you know, bad places. If you do it right, you can save a lot of money. And it worked out for me very well. Mm-hmm. What I do remember is that there was something about remedial classes, mm-hmm. because, for instance, when I started, my ACT for writing, I didn't pass. So I had to take a remedial writing, and then I did the other, you know, English, whatever, worked out very well. But now, so how does it work with the curriculum? So are we teaching them the high school curriculum with like a little bit more for college credit? Are this the equivalent to those remedial courses where you might be paying for 6 credits but you're only getting credit for 2? Is it how's that gonna work, and how does it compare to, you know, for someone who'll say, well, instead I'll just get a GED and go to Normandale. Although you kind of answered some of that, because the support really is extra. It's not what you get at a community college, so that kind of answers that. But it's kind of what
it's
is
a really great
like?
Question. In an actual statute, it gives a provision for ALC students that they can. So you have to take an ACCUPLACER, which tells you which. So I went to community college too. I went to PSU my senior year in Coon Rapids to Oak Ramsey, and then I went the next year to save money because I was poor. I paid for college. So then I transferred to the U because I could save all that money. So I agree with you. First of all, community colleges are a really great resource that oftentimes if kids don't have the motivation, they don't use as well as they could, but they're a great resource. Secondly, there is a provision in statute that MDE issued a couple of years ago that says ALC students are exempt from having to take remedial classes if they place lower on the active placer. So they should have the same opportunity, and specifically just for them. Now, the truth is that every student at RSEP this spring, we're going to probably have to take an active placer because we want them to have an idea of where they're at. They need to have that information. We have to have that information. Would there be classes that they would be able to take that are remedial in nature? Yes, there are. They can qualify for those. But it's really important. The president said this in the meeting of Normandale. Dr. Esther said that she wanted those students to be as mainstream as possible because if we're going to give them the college experience, we want them. So if they're in a remedial class, they're going to be in a remedial class with other students. So think of it this way. Think of it as two parallel tracks, right? One is the Richfield, Normandale prep track. Those are high school classes. They're taking with our staff, with our math teacher, our science teacher, our social studies teacher. Those are high school courses, high school curriculum that are all aligned to standards. Then they have the opportunity to take a second track, and that's that parallel track where they can choose one college class or two college classes that they think they could be successful in. Every single Normandale prep student in the first semester next year will take one college class. It's called NCC 1000. It's a 1 hour, once a week class from a Normandale professor that helps them sort of get ready for college. Here are the skills that you need to be successful. I already know that's not enough for our kids, and so what we'll be doing is we will be adding to that class with our business teacher and our counselor, and they'll be teaching the other 4 days a week during that hour, things like going to the library and actually researching versus Googling everything. I mean, there are some skills that our kids are going to need on that campus that we have to make sure we provide for them, but in that fall semester, they'll be earning that one college credit, and they'll also be earning the credit for the other class that we provide with our staff. So it's a sort of a mutual agreement there. Second semester, for those students that pass that class, they'll have the opportunity to choose some college classes. We're going to be very selective with this. I will tell you right now, with our counselor, Cassie Acostacano, sitting right there right now, we can tell you that we probably have five or six students that can take college-level math. Like, they're very good at math. They struggle in language, they struggle in writing, but they're very good at math. We have several students that would be able to take a college-level comp class because they're good writers, they can read very well, but they struggle in math. So where they struggle, we'll support from our high school end. The other thing that we're going to do as a preventative measure is we're going to, this summer, part of our work and this spring, is to meet with the Normandale staff, the teachers that will be teaching some of our kids by department, and we will begin to embed some of those pieces that are the big targets for success. So if we meet with the comp staff and they tell us, you got to be able to do these three things, we're going to try to embed those in our curriculum and our teaching. So it gives our students multiple opportunities to have experience with that so that when they get to that college level class, which is very rigorous, at a community college or a career college, they have an opportunity and they've seen it before so they can be successful. I don't know if that answers all of your questions.
A couple of things that were embedded in the question I just want to be clear about. Each of these classes are completely free to our students, as are all obviously college-based credit classes for our students who are enrolled in our high schools. So I just want to make sure that we're all on the same page as far as that goes.
Oh, it just popped in my head. Transportation, how would we handle transportation, say, from here to the Normandale campus? Or is transportation provided now for students?
So we have sort of three ways in which I'm approaching this, and I'm working with Dan in transportation now, but there are really three ways. First reality is that most of our students drive, and most PSEO students drive. Now, that's not all of our students. Second reality is that Normandale is actually a hub for transportation, and so buying a bus ticket that lasts for 12 weeks is like $80. That's very inexpensive. Third is we're exploring, there may be, and I'm working with MDE on this, there may be monies available, although don't quote me on that, there may be monies available for transportation. And we're thinking of a morning and then an afternoon Richfield-Normandale prep bus that would maybe come to the high school and pick everybody up in one shot, go to Normandale and bring them back or something like that. Can't guarantee that, but we're working on that.
Okay, thank you.
I just want to go back and pick up a little bit of what you asked. I've talked to LaTanya extensively. She knows what's happening. We've been talking all the time around how is this going to benefit students. And to what Superintendent Unowski indicated earlier, we are going to be able to identify 20 students at least that are current juniors and seniors that are off track of graduation. And many of those students are at risk. They're volatile. They don't attend as often as they should. And our plan is to go to those students and say, we have a new option for you next year. Would you attend? Would you come to this? And would you follow the rules of this new place if it gives you this opportunity? You may not graduate on time with your class. However, when you do graduate, you won't be behind your peers. You'll already have college credit. Because they have that option now, but without the support that we're going to provide by being there, it's not really truly an option.
So, but this may be redundant, but I'm gonna go ahead and ask it anyway. Because, I mean, I think the piece that what I've heard over the years from RCEP that has been key to the success of that program has been the support and has been the capacity of the teachers and staff at RCEP to really connect with these kids personally, very personally, to form those tight bonds to support these kids. So I think what I'm hearing from you is that the vision is that level of support would continue just in a different setting, and you would try to sort of scaffold around that support around the kids as they're sort of reaching out into the Normandale community. And it sounds like you've been sort of kind of gradually, in a very guided way, introduce these kids into a more rigorous environment?
The truth is we have students right now that could probably do some aspects of Normandale, maybe not all four, but with that support, like those three students I mentioned earlier, mm-hmm. that all attempted it this year, but walked away from it because it was too much without that support. The other piece is that there are all sorts of programmatic functions that are built into this program that aren't necessarily in the slide. So each teacher will have a caseload of students, and they will meet with those students 30 minutes a week to go over where are they at, what do they need, what's happening in your college class, where you need support. We'll have advising hours where students can come in, and there'll be one of our licensed staff there to support them with whatever that support is. We have a lot of students that walk in the door in the morning, and frankly, because we know them so well, we can, we can talk to them, we can calm them down. School's a safe place for them. It's a place where they get lunch. It's a place where they have friends. It's a place where they know that no matter what they do, and sometimes they make some bad choices, but more often than not, they make really good choices because of the respect they have for the culture that's been built around the staff that has been there this past many years. Mm-hmm. So you're exactly right. We want to keep that. We want to move it over there, but then really build and integrate within what we do so that we don't lose that personal touch. That's what makes our program successful. We think that's what will make it successful for other students coming into it in the future.
I think that's also the piece that makes it different. It's not always easy to get a team where Jason's going to show up at Normandale, not at the central building, and Cassie's going to show up to work every day at the Normandale campus, not at the central building, and Cassie's going to change her schedule based on the Normandale College classes, and so they will be following the Normandale calendar, so the kids are fully supported. The team is going to realign their curriculum and their timing of teaching to align to the Normandale calendar. So our job is to be so flexible with our work that we're finding structures to support the students by bringing basically the best of everything we have to the Normandale campus to provide them the level of supports to make sure that it's successful. That is what, to me, again, makes this so exciting and so innovative, is that's not common to have both as a district, that's not common to have as a school, and that's not common to have as a staff. It really takes putting students first.
So the other question I have for you, Jason, and you may or may not know the answer to this, I understand from whether it be media reports or reports from the higher ed department at the state that the rate at which students who enter 2 and 4 year programs actually complete them is less than we would like it to be. Can you tell me, is that particular rate something that Normandale tracks? And something that they're looking to improve upon, and might this partnership be yet another way to kind of support it?
Yeah, a couple things. If you go back to the slide on the strategic plan alignment, they in 2014 had about 104 students that came to them from Richfield High School. 104. After that first year, only 36% of those students remained. And after that second year, only a single digits of those students remain. because either they weren't ready, either other life choices got in the way, or other external factors in their life got in the way for them. And so the second piece to answer your question is that they are in the middle of a community in which currently they're only serving 6% of their entire population is Hispanic. 6%. That is awfully low. It is part of their strategic plan, it is part of their marketing and advertising plan, and it's part of their mission and vision, as you'll see in the slides, to increase those numbers. But they haven't had an effective marketing strategy to do that. And when we first started talking, I said, you know, we got about 50 kids and like 47 of them are Hispanic. And there are other students out there in other buildings, in other school districts that would jump at this opportunity. And so just that one ethnic minority, but we believe, you know, we have a Somali student, we have some other students, African-American students that would benefit from this. I look at this, to be truthful, I look at this as an equity initiative. Right now, students of color in and around Richfield technically have the opportunity to go to college if they graduate the high school or if they choose to go PSEO, if they can manage that. But in reality, a lot of students who are at risk, off track from graduation, not attending, are that way because of factors that get in the way, life factors that get in the way. You know, we have three students that had babies this year, you know, and they came to us because they didn't want to have the babies at the school. And they still got their education, they'll be coming back, and they've heard about this program. So we have the opportunity to build relationships with students, not just in Richfield, but in and around Richfield, and help support that college mission, while at the same time realizing our vision of inspiring, empowering all students to learn, grow, and excel. That's the thing that's exciting for me. I was able to navigate that by myself as a high school kid, but a lot of our students can't navigate that by themselves. They don't have some of the same advantages that I have. But they're willing to when they want to. So yes, the answer is, I think, we get a lot of those students, and they know their numbers, they track everything very well in-house, and so to get 50 kids or 60 kids that don't look like me all of a sudden on their doorstep in the fall is a huge shift culturally for that campus, and we anticipate growing that even more.
So, yeah, I think you know, I think we've touched then on some data points that we can monitor. We can monitor, obviously, the enrollment in the program to get a sense of how we're doing. We can monitor, obviously, graduating high school, which this is all stuff that we would be monitoring anyway. We can keep an eye then on how these kids do post high school graduation and if they're able to complete their program at Normandale as well. That'd be great to see. And it'll impact our bottom line as far as Richfield students, you know, the total numbers of Richfield students that complete successfully their 2 and 4 year experience. Yeah.
I think the day, you know, we're talking a little bit today and this week, where they're coming in, they're coming in as a staff, we're meeting tomorrow around some of these pieces, and one of the things we've talked about is the day that all of us can go to not just a high school graduation, but a college graduation for one of our off-track kids. That'll be a really proud day. We're looking forward to that day. So I just want to thank you for the opportunity to come and explain a little bit about some of the basics of what the program's going to be. We certainly encourage you to come out and take a look and see what's happening. And if you have more questions, I'm happy to answer because there are a lot of details. But we're working very hard on those details, and we're really excited for this opportunity. So thank you.
Okay.
Thank you very much.
Well, it's an exciting opportunity.
And Jason's job and the RCEPS team job is to make this look easy for us because when you have a small program, 45, 50 kids, you have a small staff, 5 to 7 adults, we're looking at something that's flexible and very easy to move around. But what they're also doing is they're helping to pave the way for what we see down in the future for our high school. And as we think about some of the things we've been talking about with regard to future options for 7 period days and for expanded college options for our students, our high school team has begun a conversation around what does that really look like at Richfield High School. And so they're starting to have a conversation around a model called Early College, where all of our students have the option of taking high school credits or college credits, where our graduation credits are more bundled, so to speak. And when I say bundled, I mean a student can take an English class, and it can be a college in the school's English class, it can be an AP English class, it can be a Normandale Community College English class, and it can be a high school English class. And any of those 4 classes will meet the graduation requirements. And then we go and we do that across multiple curricular areas. And all of a sudden we find that our students are doubling from the $600,000 of tuition credits that we saved their families. But now we're counting up in the millions because we're really, really making that focus on having our students, while they're getting high school credits, also have the option of taking more and more college credits in their place. And so we look forward to the RCEP team launching this with our ALC students. And then we look forward to the planning and hopefully following suit as we look towards early college at the high school.
So excellent. We can go ahead and move on to our next item on the agenda, which is the superintendent update.
Superintendent update with regard to strategic planning. And actually, I'm going to talk a little bit about facilities, because part of our strategic plan is to have the most effective facilities to serve our students. And we are looking at completing a facility study to really look at how are we doing from a building's perspective. And Mr. Holgi is going to share a little bit of information about that.
Yep. I just want to give a couple updates regarding some of the work that we're doing in facilities. Part of the strategic plan, as you're all aware, well aware, I believe, of interest in having a facility study completed. Dan Kretzinger and I have been working. We submitted an RFP or put an RFP out in January. We had eight responses from either project management firms or architects that were interested in doing that study for us. The scope of the study really is high level intensity, reviewing our infrastructure, our facilities, our space, our mechanicals. Much of this work was done at the high school last year as part of an ICS recommissioning program. We're looking at expanding that work district-wide without doing the recommissioning, but looking at what is the state of our infrastructure, our plumbing, our building the outside of the buildings, the hardscapes of the buildings, and things like that. And then the secondary component of that is to take a look at our educational programming and how would we want to change our education or our structure, our facility structure, to improve our educational programming and look at how do we take our education into the 21st century in a school environment. So we're going to, a good chunk of that study is going to be done behind the scenes by our group that is selected or will ultimately be selected to do the work as far as looking at the mechanicals. But we'll be looking at gathering feedback from community members, from board members, from staff across the district to kind of do some dreaming or kind of development around the ideas of what do we want our classrooms to look like? How do we use our space differently so it is a welcoming environment, which again drives into our educational program or into our strategic plan, as well as providing that 21st century learning environment. So one of the things that kind of initiated this last fall is we always talk about, well, we need that reserve for when the boiler goes out. Well, this year we had a boiler go out. Luckily, in our buildings, we have two boilers, and so we were able to make it through the winter and develop some contingencies. But one of the projects that we have going on this spring is to do a boiler replacement at Richfield Dual Language School. And so we've been working with the group that did the recommissioning at the high school to kind of develop some ideas and framework. And that'll also be finalized as part of this project. We're actually going to be taking the project in a few different stages. The first part of the stage is the abatement of that current boiler that failed earlier this winter, at the fall winter transition. So taking that abatement out, that's about a $22,000 project. By the time we get done with the whole project, it'll be about a $140,000 project to get that boiler replaced. What we will be doing is, implementing that boiler system with a more efficient model that will be highly effective in that area. And it's also something that we're already building into our current long-term facilities maintenance. But we don't want to end up in another situation where we have that surprise in the middle of the season. And so part of this project of doing the facility study then is to build a long-term facilities maintenance plan, look at our budget, what's available to us, what are the resources that are needed to keep our systems and our structure working, as well as make those improvements in our educational environment. So just wanted to give that brief update here today as we go into the strategic plan, because you'll see that that's aligned as part of that as well. One other piece, and it's kind of separate from this, but we are doing a lot of cleaning of house. We have a lot of things that have been stored in the basements of the buildings and things like that, and a lot of surplus that really isn't being used anymore, but hasn't necessarily been sold or anything like that. So one of the things that we're also working on, and we'll be coming with more information about this later on, is creating an auction site or working with a government auction site that allows us to dispose of that surplus in a legal way, making sure it's communicated and people have an opportunity to bid on that, and it's a competitive bidding process. So as we have those items and devices that are no longer being used and have exited from service, that we have a transition plan for that other than finding corners of the buildings in different places where things can be stored. So those are a few things that we're working on right now in the facilities group.
Questions for Mr. Holgi around the facilities study? This was last done in 2004, so I think I'm really glad that we're updating that.
Is this study both looking at what currently we have within Richfield Public Schools and what we want given our strategic plan, and what facilities are like in surrounding or comparable districts, or is it really just focused on where we are right now in Richfield and sort of staying agnostic to what our neighbors and,
no,
and others have?
All of the firms that have bid on this business have educational experience, and that's one of the things that we're looking at is what information do they have about what's out there.
Okay.
The nice thing about architecture is they're building new buildings, you know, that's kind of died down a little bit, and so a lot of their work also is in remodeling projects. I learned a new word last week when we were doing one of the interviews. We have postmodern buildings, so which have their own unique needs and issues and kind of reconfigurations and things like that. So what we're finding is that some of the ideas that they have is how do we create more common learning spaces instead of having just kind of structured classrooms? And our structured classrooms are built up, but how do we look at how do we use our media centers differently? How do we look at the design of the buildings? How do we make sure that when people are coming into the buildings, we have that security entrance that has a little bit more opportunity to kind of manage the incoming visitors and residents and guests and things like that. So we're looking at security, we're looking at the infrastructure. I kind of keep saying about 80% of our project is going to be infrastructure, just because we have, you know, buildings that were built in the 1950s and 60s, and so that's the point that we're needing to do this. But we also want to make sure that as we look at that planning for our facilities, we're looking at the educational environment, we're looking at what are our needs now, but where are they going? So if we look at early childhood programming and some of the proposals that are coming out of the state regarding that, how do we make sure that we have a plan that can be easily turned around if the funding becomes available to transition spaces that way? How do we make sure that as we're looking at our technology utilization and things like that and kind of growing that we have not just the infrastructure in place that way, but we have environments that make it friendly for individuals to engage in that technology and the one-to-one learning where students are more independent and aren't necessarily just in front of a teacher or teachers in front of a classroom. So we're looking at all of that, looking at the space that's around us and looking at the market to make sure that we have that place that people come in here and say, you know what, this is where I want my kid to go to school.
All right, so with that, it's time to provide a brief update on our strategic plan. You have about a 20-page document in your board pack, and so I'm just going to reiterate that last year we went through a strategic planning process where we redid our mission. We then created a strategic plan with some details around it, and then the work of this year is really to create a set of responsible parties and sort of a timeline for some of those activities. So what you have in front of you today is the umpteenth draft of some of that work, and I'm just going to talk to you a little bit about how this works and why are we going this direction. One of the conversations about a strategic plan is how do you make it a living document, and how is it not just a piece of paper that sits on a shelf? Just to bring you back, we have four main strategies, and so I'm just going to walk you through a little bit. Strategy one, we will provide challenging, relevant, and engaging educational opportunities for all students that will increase learning. So as we think about, and what we've talked about, is how do you use a strategic plan to make some decisions and to drive your actions? So you go from our strategy, which goes down the left side for several pages, over to the actions. And so our action 1A is align pre-kindergarten through 12 curriculum and high school graduation requirements with the requirements for success in the 21st century's world's best workforce. So that is a major action. That's pre-K through 12. That's realigning curriculum and graduation requirements. So that also involves the activities to the right. So as you look down those activities, I'm just going to pick the second one, increase student learning, student use of technology. So one of our activities we'll be doing within strategy one is increasing student use of technology. Responsible for that is our technology team. It's also principals, and then on the ground, it's teachers. And then you're going to see a timeline, because there are things that we're working on now, there's things that we will be planning for the work, and there are things that are worked on in the future. So right now we are beginning that implementation, and what does that look like? It's in the comments and notes section where fifth grade and rollout of technology with media specialists. And our goal is to, by the end of our year, really reality check our current work and figure out what data reporting would look like. So if we were to talk about student increased use of technology, what does that look like from a data perspective? From my perspective, that would look like, how are we using technology in the hands of students last year? And at the end of this year, what does that look like over that course of time? So obviously, you'll note there are many boxes, many areas for us to determine each of those pieces. What does the data look like? What does the reporting look like? And how do we go down that road? An example from something we'll be going to a little bit later, if you look five steps down, you'll see develop a task force to identify current graduation requirements. Still within the same strategy, still within the same action. That's going to be the high school admin team and the teaching and learning team, and it says plan for that work. So they're beginning to gather the information about graduation requirements here and the actual action below, which is graduation requirements around us and what is required. They're expected to begin that work next year. And so as a team, the high school team is getting guidance to begin gathering information now, and they're going to start analyzing the graduation requirements. And how are they going to do that? They're going to determine the appropriate participants of their group, and they're going to do an audit of current practice and alignment to standards both of our program and of other programs. So now they'll begin to gather that for the future work that they have. And obviously this continues through four strategies, many, many activities, many actions, with responsible parties and timelines involved. So I just want to reiterate back to the first point, our goal of this year is to create those timelines. What are we tackling now? What are we tackling next year? And what is on in the future? And then we're beginning to determine what does that work look like and what is reporting back to the board. Now, a policy that we will go to later actually involves us reporting this information from a data perspective and how are we doing in the end of the school year fashion, sometime around June. So the overall plan is for us to continue clarifying responsible parties and timelines, working on the data of what reporting looks like, and be able to create our first progress report to the board in June about how are we doing in terms of the strategic plan, where are we at from this year, and what are the main actions and activities that we'll be looking towards for next year. Questions?
Are there questions for Steve on the strategic plan? I do have some. So the timelines, at this point, we've identified sort of what we're doing and what we will do. Do we have a spot where would we say when we will finish a particular activity, or do we set sort of a end point? I'm just thinking of, I know myself, to keep myself on target, sometimes I need to have that deadline pressure to kind of keep focus.
We have not at this time. However, I think that's a great piece to visit in June when we report progress to determine, are we closed with these particular activities? Or we could also add at that time, we should be looking at deadlines for completion.
So then that feeds into the second part of my question is, obviously we have gone through a prioritization process because there are some that we've chosen to begin and some that we've chosen to perhaps defer. There's obviously the element of prioritization. There's also the element of kind of resource availability and what you can do. Do we have any sense of, have we been sort of purposeful in our priorities? Is that something that's been part of this process? Or are there any of these activities where we feel that activity B is really dependent upon completing activity A before you can kind of move forward?
So it's a mixture of both. We've had actually multiple leadership team meetings in regard to our strategic plan and talking about what the work looks like, who is the responsible party, and what is a reasonable timeline. This is, and why it says draft on there, is this is our best guess at the moment. We're really going to, because it's the first year and we're just rolling it out, we're really going to have a lot of information when we try to analyze our progress and we see where we're at. It's going to give us a pretty direct reality check on what have we bitten off, what are we able to accomplish, and what are reasonable goals. There's a set of things that we were pretty clear didn't need to be tackled at the moment. So if we think about the example I used about graduation requirements, rather than really getting into that now, as we look at what would be perhaps a 7-period day, how might that impact what classes students take, how might that impact our staffing, how might that impact graduation requirements, there is a significant need for us to put that off a year as we look forward to moving towards that process prior to jumping into some of that work and some of that information. And so that created a priority base. But then also there were a lot of voices at the table basically saying, yes, these are things we're already engaged in, we're working on, we can really take steps forward. And then, oh, that's kind of a new initiative that we're going to need to push down the road a little bit. And so there were certainly prioritizations and definitely an eye on not trying to bite off more than we can chew.
What do board members think about making some of that information part of this document to have transparency in terms of the prioritization and or resource availability? I'm thinking about that from the perspective of, you know, as we think about how we're kind of aligning resources and aligning our priorities, that maybe this would be helpful. Any feedback from the rest of you on that concept?
I would agree. I think it's important. You know, if it's a resource constraint that's driving our priorities or vice versa, right? We should be clear about that so that, you know, the community knows what to expect and why we might be taking, you know, preferring one over another.
Mm-hmm. Other feedback or reflections on this document?
Is there a system for looking at how effective the chosen activities or actions are in actually coming back and succeeding in beating our strategic plan goals?
So some of them there are, and some of them we need to develop and try to figure out. So as you think about, one of the conversations you've had is around our professional learning communities and how are they doing. There are actually rubrics of implementation. Our entire team across the district, I believe, completed implementation rubrics last year. And certainly something we've talked about as a leadership team is going back to see where would we assess ourselves on that performance rubric for professional learning communities now or at the end of this particular school year. So there are ways to do that. Mm-hmm. And as we think about what are the appropriate ways to report the data, I think it's a lot of our conversation has been, we don't want this to be a checkbox. It has to be, are we doing it and are we doing it well? And if we are, is this something we want to continue? And so it sadly creates both questions and answers as we go off down the road towards working through our strategic plan.
It would be good to have that information out there too, just so that, just for the sake of transparency again, so that we can see what's working. And if you find something that doesn't work, we can say, all right, we aren't doing this anymore. It didn't bring us to the goal that we were trying to achieve.
So if I'm hearing, just reflecting back, we're looking at ideally, where possible, to add in deadline for completion, creating some clear statement of prioritization of some of the pieces, talking about adding the resources needed list to the things that we're looking at, and also a quality of implementation data within our reporting of our data.
And you're only allowed to use 10.5. No legal-sized paper.
Right. The challenge is trying to get it, and yes, I understand it shows up very small. It's trying to get it on something you can keep on a screen and yet still be able to read.
Yeah. So. Yeah. And we'd be happy to add on data points ad nauseum until you've got no other time to do anything else.
It's really helpful seeing it presented like this, broken down in this way, so I appreciate that, and I'm excited to continue talking about it and, you know, digging into what are we learning and what are the results that we're seeing. So I was really grateful to see this and know that the conversation will continue.
Absolutely. Echo those comments. Sometimes it's easy to be offering constructive criticism and not praising adequately, because this really is a very, very inspirational.
I couldn't help but notice that strategy too of attracting and retaining students, that a lot of that responsibility falls on your lap. Is that, you know, be able, you're not going to be overwhelmed, I guess is my question, with all your other responsibilities as well.
So it's important to note that just because I would be noted as the responsible party doesn't mean that I am taking all of the actions.
Okay.
So some of the communications are absolutely, and marketing are part of what I do and part of my assistant does. But for example, when we talk about having schools market to our pre-Ks in the community and daycares in the community, yes, I oversee that that's occurring. But you can bet that the four principals were actually out into all of our UCFE classes, and they're actually going around the community to daycares. And similar with transition events, yes, I am responsible for that marketing. But our middle school principal is actually hosting visits from our fourth graders and hosting visits from our fifth graders and creating events. So the responsible party doesn't necessarily mean just the actor, but they're the person who is responsible for making sure that that gets enacted.
Picture you out there like the Liberty Tax guy. You
know, I've tried to get into the Professor Sparks costume from STEM and the Sparty costume, and for whatever reason, they don't want to give it to me, so.
They're making good decisions.
Yes, they are. Yes, they are. All right, so transitioning to the next piece has to do with the beginning of the reporting back of our survey data. And so we completed our staff survey and our parent survey, and we're ready to begin reporting back and sharing some of that data. And as you survey both staff and community, I'm trying to figure out the most effective ways to look at the data and analyze the data is obviously part of our challenge. What you see in front of you is the district overall responses from staff in regard to all of our administration. So this is a complete picture of district leadership, of building leadership, and the responses of staff. So over the two-week period, we had approximately 60% of our staff, or just under 400 of our employees, fill out surveys. They were asked a set of questions, which you see summarized in front of you, and they've been categorized into three groups, minus, neutral, or plus. We determined that if a staff member stated strongly disagree or disagree, it was put into the minus category. If they put in neutral or not applicable, it was put into the neutral category. And if the staff member's response was agree or strongly agree, they were put into the plus category. So what we've done is we have begun working our way through the data and trying to determine how to report it back. And so I'm going to be modeling this for our principals tomorrow. And sharing some of the work that we're doing. So as we look at our data, you will notice in the minus column, positively promotes the district. 4% of our staff have a negative perspective on our administrative team, positively promoting the district. 23% are neutral, and 73% are positive. And so as we work our way through, looking at relative strengths and relative opportunities for growth is one of the conversations we're going to have. Because as we recall, this is our first time of a survey, so we really don't know what is great results and what are things that we want to focus on. What I will focus on is that there is no area that more than 18% of our staff have a negative perspective on the way things are going from a leadership view. So that means 80% of our staff are feeling either positive or neutral towards some of the leadership work that's occurring. If you look at relative strengths, positively promotes the district with 73%, or the second highest in the plus category, and 4% in the minus category. And then also respect that's shown between teachers towards teacher leaders and of our overall group, 80% in the plus and positive category, and only 6% in the negative. So we have some areas to leverage in terms of our strength. The reason I'm starting there is because it's very easy, and I notice my own inclination is to focus on the minus and focus on the negative. But I also want to start with what are our relative strengths. So my hope is that when we receive our parent survey results, our parents see the same thing, which is we're doing an excellent job of positively promoting our district, and we have a culture of respect towards our teacher leaders that is pervasive across our buildings. Then as we look at the areas of relative opportunity for growth, you can look at an overall climate of respect and support, where 18% had said that they would disagree or strongly disagree that that has been implemented across our administrative leadership team, also correlating with a 53% positive review. And so as we think about the things that we need to do, it's to gather some additional information about what does that look like, how do we ensure that we do have a climate of respect and support, and what would improvements look like if we were to make those. And so as principals are going to be encouraged to begin these conversations with their staffs, they're going to begin gathering additional information, because one of the things we often do is we try to leverage our strengths and fix areas with opportunities for growth without actually getting the voice of those who have responded to us. And what I mean by that is I have lots of ideas about how to fix things and how to make things better, but they're really my ideas. And the reality is when you ask a staff member their perspective, you actually have to ask that same staff person or that same group of staff, okay, how do we make that better? We also need to ask them from a positive perspective, okay, so what is it that we are doing well and how do we extend that from a positive perspective? So what we're going to be doing with our administrative leadership team is we're going to be sharing the overall administration data, and you see that, and talking about our relative areas of strength and relative areas of opportunity, and then beginning to talk about how does each leader gather additional feedback about what are our strengths and how do we leverage those, and how do we take those opportunities and how do we grow from that. And then each leader will be taking specific steps, and this will be done transparently in communication with their staffing teams, about what are steps we can do to take those steps forward and continue to improve. Finally, the last thing will be, then we'll, in hopes of giving the same survey next year and setting some goals about what are things that we can continue to work on and focus on, and using this as a baseline, truly implementing something over multiple years to see how are we doing in the eyes of our staff and how can we continue to improve that. And as we refine our reporting process, you'll obviously be seeing in April, probably the second meeting, the same type of data in regard to what are our parents having to say about our schools.
So feedback on the survey results so far. I will say that I can understand the categorization that you set up. In some ways, neutrals and non-applicables, we may not want to consider them together. I'm thinking about the one on support aligned to needs improvement plan, or support aligned to needs or improvement plan, I think is probably the way to interpret that. So for instance, we have a fairly high percentage of neutrals there.
Mm-hmm.
If most of those neutrals were not applicables,
mm-hmm.
then we may interpret that differently than if they're primarily people who are sort of saying, mm-hmm. you're all right there, you know, because we'd like to be better. So just a piece to consider. And the other piece, the other reason that one jumped out to me is it seemed like if we are able to get a lot of positive feedback on that question, it seems like that may flow into also supporting positive responses on some of the other pieces. But so anyway, at any rate, you know, when you think about, but I really do like what you're saying about your plan to start to develop an action plan by first going out and getting the feedback from the staff. I think that's the right way to do it.
I'm trying to remember, did open-ended feedback also come with these responses in the survey?
Yes, there are comments that can be broken down and shared and reviewed. Comments tend to be challenging to review. There was one in terms of areas that are going well and then opportunities for growth. And so people are reviewing the specific comments to sort of analyze. We're also disaggregating the data to try to figure out as much down to the building level information as we can. One of the things we wanted to make sure, and we worked very well with Education Richfield, is to make it an anonymous survey. You know, there are different perspectives on anonymous surveys, and what we wanted to do is make sure that it's not important the person who gives us the information, but it's important the information that we receive. And so we're really trying to use that information for growth, both from a comment perspective and then also from a scoring perspective. I think there were over 125 pages of comments written. So our staff, I was really impressed with the time and dedication staff had to giving constructive feedback and input about things that were going well and areas that we could focus on for opportunities for growth.
Steve, in that area, I have a question about that support aligned to needs improvement plan.
Mm-hmm.
And correct me if I'm wrong, I'm reading into that kind of maybe not so much awareness from the staff about is that between the strategic plan and how that's aligned to the things that we're asking of them, because I assume those neutrals are probably kind of really not, you know, neutrals not really not applicable. So I'm trying to figure out like how much do they know of what's going on, and because
so
I know it's really new, but I don't know how much, you know, I don't know exactly what has happened in the last year to gauge like how much the. I'd like to see that higher, because if we don't know where we're going, it's going to be hard to get there.
Right. So part of our data, and we began to really analyze, is that as we were giving feedback on multiple departments and multiple leadership areas, and as we're just really digging into this. How does the finance team, for example, align their support to our strategic plan and to our overall building improvement plan and our district plan? As we talked, and we talked as an upper-level leadership team just today, and what we talked about is trying to get clearer with communications about why do we go through a budget process, how do we align our budget to specifically respond to our strategic plan, and what does that exactly look like, and how do we provide financial and building-level supports in each of those areas. I think some of the neutral, and I think you hit it right on the head, has to do with a communications perspective, is both knowing what our plans are for improvement and then also knowing what each member's role is in terms of supporting that piece. And we have work in both of those areas. And then I want to go back to something I said, because I think you both kind of hit on it. You know, one of the things we have a tendency to do is to jump to trying to figure that out. And I know I try to be that person. And I know that when I go home with my wife, that's one of the worst strategies I've ever come up with in the history of the world, because I think I can fix whatever's going wrong. And what I find is if I ask more questions for clarity, is, and this is what we're asking our principals to do, is help us understand more what would that look like. That can really help the communication. So if I go to Mr. Habeck, who's sitting there, a middle school teacher, and I say, okay, so in our middle school, we said that you know, the support you're receiving is not fully aligned to our plan. Can you give more information on that? And we provide him an opportunity to share the information, and then the entire middle school team, we provide that the opportunity. The amazing thing is they're going to tell us what it would be, what it would look like to be different. And so we don't have to take my bad interpretation of what I think Jim has to say. He's gonna actually give me that information. And then we can get into that relationship where those scores do increase and we do have less neutral. And even in that area, 49% positive, 10% negative, that's still 5 positive answers for every single one in the negative column. And so it's, you know, I think you hit the nail on the head in terms of the neutral or not applicable piece. How do we break that down, and how do we really decide to be more clear within our communications?
Outstanding. Well, we will very much look forward to hearing more on this process. All right, so we can go ahead and move on to the consent agenda. If board members have any questions on the consent agenda, we can entertain those now. If not, we can look for a motion.
I'll move to approve the consent agenda.
I'll second.
So a motion by Brocky, second by Malik, that we approve the consent agenda as presented. Is there any discussion? All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Chair votes aye, the consent agenda passes. We do not have any old business this evening. We will move on to item 6A, which is notice of resolution proposing to discontinue teaching contracts and to place teachers on ULA. Mr. Holji.
Yes, thank you. This is something that we initiated at the last meeting. In the midst of all of those reductions, there was one teacher that we neglected to get processed for the resolution proposing the discontinuance of their teaching contract and placing them on teachers' placing that teacher on unrequested leave of absence. It was included in the position reductions as part of the special education position reductions, because we generally have enough probationary teachers within special education. We missed this one. This isn't in the early childhood special education area. So just asking for your approval tonight on this new teacher.
Are there questions for Mr. Holmesy on this particular item?
I just wanted to clarify the time, just an oversight that it wasn't included.
Correct.
Okay.
There are no more questions. We can entertain a motion.
I'll move the resolution.
A second.
So we have a motion by Hollis and a second by Brockie. Is there any discussion? As this is a resolution, I will pull the board. Mr. Paulus?
Aye.
Ms. Brockie?
Aye.
Mr. Ashmead?
Aye.
Ms. Malik?
Aye.
Ms. Cole?
Aye.
Chair votes aye, the resolution passes.
Thank you. I would just clarify, we brought it up last time. This is no reflection on the teacher who's involved in this. It simply is a matter of our position reductions and meeting the staffing with our new enrollment. So
we can move on now to the group health and dental coverage policy. Greg?
Very good, thank you. So Member Paulus knows I always knock on wood as soon as I start talking about our insurance policy and our insurance plan, because in general, it's been running very well. I'm here to update you kind of with the update on requesting a renewal, but then also to provide new information regarding our self-funded plan and kind of a history, so that we kind of keep ourselves baselined on the goals of this plan and moving forward. Specifically with this, the Insurance Advisory Committee met and has a recommendation of a 0% increase to the medical benefit premium funding. Again, we're in a self-funded plan, so we don't actually pay premiums to an insurance company. We pay premiums to a reserve account within our own budget. That is dedicated for our health care plan and our medical plan and can only be used for our Medicare plan. In this 0% increase, it also includes a 5% reduction in our stop loss premium. Because of our claim utilization, we were able to negotiate a reduction in our stop loss. There is a projected 2.8% increase in our expected claims from what the expected claims that we set this year. So again, we're running below trend. And we are also at this time recommending no plan design changes, even though every year we take a look at what are some opportunities around those no plan design changes. On a much smaller scale, we are also recommending a 0% increase to the dental benefit premium funding. There was a 5% increase in administrative costs from $425 to $447 per employee per month as part of that plan from Delta. We have not had an administrative increase in at least the 3 years that corporate health has been with us in managing this. We also have a 1% reduction in claims is anticipated, and we're recommending no plan design changes. We're anticipating that in both of these, with the 0%, we will still likely continue to accrue in our reserve account, and so we're looking at how do we manage that most appropriately. Where those rates are at, they are staying consistent. Currently, we have two plans in our health plan. One is a $1,250 high deductible plan for single with a $2,500 maximum for family. And then we have a $2,500 single with a $5,000 deductible plan for family. The most single full-time employees that are taking single coverage are on that $1,250 plan. Most of our families that are taking coverage are on that $5,000 deductible plan, and that's just a matter of what the deductible is compared to what the premium contribution would be just to pay premiums automatically. For most employees, they're saving money by having that higher deductible plan as part of their annual savings. And then with the Delta Dental plan, we have a unique situation. We have a composite rate, and then if that composite rate goes above what's set into each one of our contracts, then families would pay that difference. We kind of have a blended family rate. So our single family rate within the district is $59 per month, and for families, it's $70.66 per month. So if you are used to other dental plans, the single is more expensive than a traditional single, but it's because we have that blended composite rate that's part of our program. Thought I'd give a little bit history of self-funded plans and a little information about it, just because as the board, you are the fiduciary agents for our self-funded health and dental insurance plans. Oftentimes when we moved into this, there was concern about how much risk are we taking on. We really work to manage that risk. We make sure that we're not putting district assets that are used for other funds at risk that would then be impacting our program as a whole. So in a self-funded plan, the employer pays the direct cost of the actual claims incurred by the group. Payments, networks, coverage, and compliance are all administered by a plan administrator. In our district, since we initiated the plan, we've been using Preferred One as part of that plan. And then the plan design, the coverage, and additional benefits are determined by the employer group for their specific plan. So when we were fully insured, we basically would pay X dollars in based on what that premium was, and whatever wasn't used by our members went to fund the rest of that larger group plan or that larger health insurance plan as part of that. In this situation, what we don't spend for our direct claims and our administration is retained in the district in a reserve account specifically to be used for this purpose. When we moved into this plan, we thought that we had some opportunities for savings given the information when we initiated the plan, but we really did not rely on the savings because ultimately if you're paying for healthcare, long-term, short-term, you're paying for that healthcare. Whether you're putting it into a larger pool and that pool helps you out in the long run, or if you're just paying into it. So ultimately you're paying into it no matter what. We really moved into it in regard to transparency of costs. A lot of times we find out that there's a lot of uncertainties about what exactly you're paying for. Sometimes there are things that maybe aren't important to an employer or aren't important to an employee that you might be paying. And so that transparency of costs, how that was funded. We also saw opportunities for reduced fees and taxes. Because we're self-funded, we have different fees that we're responsible for that are less than fully insured plans. And so that was another component of it, is that savings was the savings that we knew. And then we were really looking at this as long-term cost control. So in this situation, we moved into the plan with a commitment to building a reserve that would help us sustain kind of those ups and downs that we would see on a year-to-year basis. If you have a high year claim, we wanted to be able to have enough reserve that we could fund that and not have a 20% increase in our premium. That then makes it a lot more difficult for us to plan in our budget and move that forward at that time. And then the localized control of utilization. And Gary Schutte the other night talked about how people start to feel like this is a part of their plan. They see the funds and what isn't used in the plan. If we're using our healthcare smart, intelligently, if we are using making the right choices for our healthcare, if we're making the correct pharmacy choices and prescription choices and are using generics when possible, that those have things that can really save the district money that ultimately allows us to use more of our resources that we would otherwise be paying to a health insurer, to put those back into the classroom and fund that in that situation. As far as plan oversight, we have an insurance advisory committee that really looks at, that includes representatives of each of the bargaining groups. We review the health and dental plan design and utilization, make sure that we're running on track, that we are anticipating claims in the future that are coming up. We review the customer service needs, how well is Preferred One managing our program, review and prioritize the cost avoidance strategies. One of the things we had this year as part of our insurance advisory committee was talking about pharmaceutical benefits and how there's a lot of money that goes a lot of different places. And so we're initiating a campaign that talks about, depending on which pharmacy you go to, you can actually pay a 10% premium just to go down the street to a different individual or different pharmacy. We also found, and this surprised me, and I think it surprised everybody on the committee, is that typically we've been trained to think if you get a 3-month prescription, you're gonna save money because you don't pay the dispensing fees. And so there's some savings that way. We saw some pharmacies that were charging $11 for a generic on a monthly basis, but if you do that as a 3-month fill, you pay $77. So again, you are paying a premium to take your prescription all at once versus having it taken month after month. Not every pharmacy is that, and so we're looking at some information communication to help inform people that if you're making this choice, this is what the cost is to the plan, because our employees still pay their copay no matter what. So those are a lot of those hidden pieces that we really were kind of driving into figuring out how do we improve our work. And when I hear employees who are on the insurance advisory committee talking about that and just in shock, I know that there's that ownership, which is one of the goals that we really had, is making those smart decisions. It doesn't mean that you're not going to the doctor when you need to. It just means you're making the right choices at the right time and when you have opportunities to take care of yourself and your wellness in the first place. And then the Richfield Board of Education, as I said, is the fiduciary agent. We ultimately, as the district and you as the board, are ultimately responsible for the financing behind this. So when we establish the premiums, or that premium contribution or funding contribution. That's making sure that we have a plan that's running where it's supposed to be. Human resources and the finance department are really managing that, and then we work with corporate health as our consultant on this to make sure that our benefits are in line and that we are meeting all of our regulations that are associated with our self-funded plan, and then advising, providing additional perspective on our underwriting. Talked about managing risk. We have always been intentional about being conservative and managing our risk as much as possible. We have a $100,000 stop loss, specific stop loss policy, which ensures any individual that the claims that go against the plan will not exceed $100,000 in any fiscal year, which for our plan is July through June. So if an individual has a $200 of claims, the district only pays for the $100,000, and we're paying premium for that specific stop loss to cover that additional. We also have aggregate stop loss, which says our claims will go no more than 25% what the expected claims are. So that's kind of our worst case scenario. That insurance ends up being about $10,000 a year for our entire $6 million policy, which is not a lot, but it tells you how committed they are to making sure that our plan does not exceed that $25,000 stop loss.
Craig, didn't we edge that down to 115 this year?
We did the 115 when we moved into the plan, but we've moved that back to the 125. So we did take a look at the 115. Actually, we did not look at the 115 this year, but when we moved into the plan, and I'll talk a little bit about that as we get into the history here, we really had nothing to lose here. And then funding appropriately, building and maintaining an appropriate plan reserve, cost covering the maximum cost in a plan year plus runout. So those maximum costs are that 25% beyond expected claims or administrative costs plus any runout, and then providing additional reserve to mitigate the future increases. And then rate planning, we have fixed costs. These are the administrative costs, the cost for preferred one to process the claims, to have their network in place for us to receive the discounts that preferred one has for network, the premium for the stop loss coverages, any employee assistance programs that we are providing, and then the fees that are associated with the Affordable Care Act and other taxes and things like that. And then we use underwriting to help us manage our rates as well. We use both corporate health and preferred one for that underwriting to make sure that we're getting a couple different perspectives and then following our reserve goals, which we'll talk about here. When we moved into year one and when we were at Fiscal Planning Advisory Committee, Dave Lamberger is on that committee, and he remembers making this move, and he says that was the smartest thing that our employees and our district ever did and that we did as a board. Because we had the opportunity when we went out for bid, and it was a situation where I was starting to think about self-funded, but people told us that we were too small to do self-funded. We just do not have the number of employees to do that, the number of plans, and so we were discouraged from doing that. We were planning to move to continue in our fully funded plan, but we did a self-funded plan at the same time, and Medica was our current provider. They came back with about a $500,000 reduction in our premium that year. And that was after years of 3%, 5%, so not large claims or not large increases, but about a $500,000 reduction there. And Medica basically had put together a plan that we could not lose money in that first year and provided us the opportunity to try it and jump in, knowing that we would walk out at the end of the year, maybe not with that full savings of the first year of the health plan, but looking at those long-term strategies, we had that opportunity. So when we moved in, we switched from Medica to Preferred One for the administration piece. We had a reserve goal of 10 to 13% of expected claims at the end of year one, and that was pretty much guaranteed if we hit our expected claims. So we likely weren't going to lose that. A goal of having 25% of expected claims after 3 years and then continuing to build to mitigate future increases. Our plan experience that year was our claims and costs were 85% of the funding levels. So we had put aside that 15% at the end of year one. We had $887,000 in our reserve account at the end of year one. We had, which was 16.5%, 51% of the total cost and 20% of the expected claims. So immediately we had some savings that way. Year two, July 2013 to June 2014, we had no plan design changes. We took a 4% increase in premiums. We continued that reserve goal, increased funding to reach 25% of expected claims. Which were our maximum costs after 3 years. We thought that that increase of 4%, which again was pretty small at the time, would allow us to get to that 25%. And we continued wanted to continue to mitigate the future increases by building a reserve of 40 to 50%. Our plan experience there was 82.7% of the funding levels, and so we had a reserve after year two of $1.98 million, which was 36% of the total cost and 41% of expected claims. So I keep knocking on wood every time I have a chance to do that. Last year was our third year, July 2014 to June 2015. We had no plan design changes and implemented a 0% increase in premiums. So we had a 0, a 4, and a 0. Our reserve goals were to continue to grow to that 40 to 50%. We reviewed specific stop loss coverage and looked at possibly increasing it to $125,000 versus $100,000, but the $64,000 savings in the premium cost really did not warrant making that change and putting that additional money at risk, so we kept it at the $100,000. Last year, our cost of funding ratio was 86%, and our total reserve at the end of last year was $2.3 million. 36.62 of our total costs, and now 46% of our expected claims at the end of last year. And last year, we actually had a fairly high increase right at the end of the year. Otherwise, when we were looking at this point last year, it was looking even stronger. So I keep knocking on wood. And then moving into plan four, July 2015 to June 30, 2016. So last year, we actually did a Health Insurance Transparency Act, which was the new state law that requires two-year proposals from school districts to go out to bid either on administrative costs or on fully insured plans. So we did that fully compliant RFP last year. We did take a look at the Public Employee Insurance Program, which is a state program that is a managed self-funded plan. We had Preferred One, Medica Health Partners, and CCS is Blue Cross Blue Shield's, one of their administrative arms that really looks at administrative costs or administration of plans. And all of those submitted proposals along with PEEP. We ended up making no plan design changes. We actually had the opportunity to reduce our premiums by about 6%, but we recommended maintaining the 0% just to mitigate future increases. So wanting to continue to build the reserve, thinking if you go down, people don't remember when you reduce your premiums, they only remember when you increase your premiums. And again, building that long-term sustainability, going back to that foundational piece, was really a commitment of us as we move forward that way. We have started to implement some wellness programs. One of the things that we're rolling out here in April is a biometric screening for our employees and an opportunity for them to do their biometric screenings. And then they can log in to Preferred One and participate in some health assessments that they can then generate some $25 rewards for participating in that program that help make sure that they're making informed decisions with their healthcare plans. We're currently running at 78% of our funding levels despite taking another 0% increase. And our projected reserve right now at the end of the year is $2.89 million. So again, we built this up to that 40 to 50% cost factor reserve that we're looking at moving forward. And so with that, we bring this plan year five, looking at no plan design changes. We considered a 7% reduction in premiums this year, but again, are recommending a 0% to mitigate future increases, knowing also that we had some high claims roll out at the end of last year, wanting to make sure that before we take reductions or kind of start to draw out of our reserves, that we aren't doing that. Our reserve goals really have been achieved, and that we did do a review of our specific stop loss coverage again at the 100 and 125, ended up being able to negotiate that 5% reduction in our specific stop loss premium because of our claims, and so again stayed at that $100,000 just to mitigate that risk and keep that opportunity within the district. When we take a look at this, this is corporate health goes through and does some assessments regarding our underwriting. We take a look at what our claims were for the current year and the previous 2 years. Look at the annual claims associated with that. We trend those forward with about a 6.5% increased trend, and then build out what those expected claims would be for each one of those years, and then average those. When we look at our current utilization and our current year only, we could take a 2.4% reduction in our expected claims. If we look at a two-year blended, it's a 3.2% increase in expected claims, and if we do a three-year claims, it's a 3.5% increase in claims. So there's a lot of analysis that goes around that, but we're trying to make some informed decisions, and this helps make sure that when Preferred One or any insurance carriers or administrators are giving us their expected claims, that they're staying true to what our methods would be, or we have some ability to look at it and make sure that we understand why those might be different. Preferred One came in And they are showing a 2.8% increase in our expected claims from what our expected claims were at for this year. So that is right along the lines of where our corporate health was looking at their claims. Here we have the current enrollment. We have the fixed costs, which we talked about, the stop loss, specific individual deductibles, the aggregate premiums. We have our administrative costs, which include the medical administration. We have a fitness reimbursement program for employees that if they participate, go to a fitness club and they participate and attend, I believe it's 12 times per month, and they get a $20 savings or credit to that healthcare plan. So we pay for that directly, our employee assistance program. Last year we initiated telemed, which was an opportunity for employers to offer online access to physicians for kind of low-level triage treatments and things like that. That actually has been reduced, so we don't have to pay anything for that service through Preferred One at this point. And then we have those Affordable Care Act reinsurance fees, and then healthcare reimbursement, I believe, research fee. And then the consulting fee is the fee that we pay towards corporate health for the benefits. We pay a flat dollar amount, so it's not based on increases to premiums or things like that, that they get benefits. Again, the plan design changes there, and then we show what those expected costs are under the Preferred Ones renewal. The second column is that increase from $100,000 to $125,000 premium, which was really only about a $50,000 savings for that plan. And then corporate health's two-year blended renewal applying those same fixed cost rates. And then finally, when we get to the rate setting, we take a look at that funding analysis, looking at the different funding rationales of a 45%, a 40%, a 35%, and the max plus 8%, which is that 25% of ag and administrative plus 8%. This is the funding that would be required each one of those years. So the funding for next year to maintain the 45% is $6.3 million. Right now we're funding at $6.8 million, so we anticipate that we will continue to see that reserve account built. This is where that funding would show that we had the opportunity to reduce our premiums by 7%, but are recommending that we hold constant at 0% again this year, just to make sure that we have that reserve built up and the long-term planning associated with that. So quiz, what do these numbers mean?
Premium
increases. Yep. So, very good. So, the zero, we moved into self-funded with 0%, second year 4%, and now we have 3 years of 0% as long as you approve that ratio set for this or the premium funding for next year. And 0.8%?
I'll let them answer.
Defer to the medical professional.
Hope I did my math right. 0.8% is our annual cost increase for our health insurance premiums. So you take 4 divided by 5. Did I do my math right?
No,
it's close. I know it's trended and everything else like that.
It gets a little
trend.
It's a little lower than 0.8%
okay.
a year.
Okay.
Compound.
Okay, yeah. So simple math. I was going for simple math.
Sorry.
So. Again, we're asking for a 0% increase to the medical benefit premium funding and a 0% increase to the dental benefit premium funding for the current year and setting the rates at these rates again and holding those constant.
I'm really happy to hear about the expansion of the wellness program. I think that's a great thing. It's big in a lot of companies. The University of Minnesota has a huge program. That's a really great way to expand this.
We've really worked to reinvent that. Last year when we did our RFP, Preferred One actually provided a $15,000 incentive to build that wellness program. So we received $15,000 this year and $15,000 next year to apply towards that. We can use some of the funds within our reserve for wellness programs for individuals who are in the plan. We can't use those for other employees who are not in the plan, which is where that $15,000 helps us allocate resources into those individuals. So we're not just saying, well, if you're in our insurance plan, you get this, and if you're not, you don't get it. That biometric screening is kind of the first step, making sure that people are making informed decisions. And then we've been working to develop a plan next year that includes a lot more communication. So there's raising awareness and things like that. We believe that that's gonna continue to help us to maintain these rates in the future and kind of bring down costs further.
Any other questions for Craig?
or for Tim, I know as our liaison to this group, was the discussion and recommendation unanimous and consistent across the group, or are there questions or other pieces of information that are important for us to know?
The only other thing, I would say it's unanimous, and I'll let you kind of weigh in on it. One of the things that we talked about is, do we do the reduction? One of the opportunities that we have as a district, potentially, if we continue to save and accrue and it builds so big, is we can take a premium holiday where we would take a month off from paying that premium. So the district contribution and employee contributions to those premiums, we'd be able to relieve that. So that then provides opportunity to kind of use those funds differently. We wanted to make sure we really know where we're at and have some longer term discussions about what's the benefit around that, knowing that sustainability of this, that if we can build more years of 0% increase, that that ultimately helps us long term. So that would be the one other discussion point that we had without a formal recommendation at this point of saying let's do it. It was a let's wait till the beginning of next year and make a determination if we want to move forward with that.
I would agree that it was the mood of the room, it was unanimous. It was pretty clear. And the group did vote unanimously for to stay flat at 0% instead of taking up to a 7% decrease. Part of the reason people self-insure is to get control of the cost and have cost predictability. Mm-hmm. And so if you take the small increase or decrease at every opportunity mm-hmm. that comes, you're sort of back on the same mm-hmm. mini roller coaster that you might be in the commercial insurance market. Mm-hmm. So.
We can entertain a motion to approve the recommendations on this on the premiums if they're board members so inclined.
I'll move the recommendation.
I'll second.
So we have a motion by Paulus and a second by Ashmi that we approve the premiums as recommended. Is there any discussion? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
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 Any opposed? My motion carries.
I'm going to knock on wood again, just sorry.
Right, so then the medical renewal, I believe, is so next. Am I correct on that?
That was the medical and dental.
That was the medical and dental.
We have life and LTD up next.
Correct, thank you.
Again, more good news regarding our employee benefit programs and our insurances. We received our renewal rates for our long-term disability insurance and our life insurance. These, like our dental plan, are both much smaller plans and cost to the district overall. Long-term disability is about $135,000 to $140,000. Our life insurance is about $50,000. Our dental is about $200,000, I believe it was. Here we have Madison National Life. We have a 5% reduction in our long-term disability from 0.501% of insured payroll to 0.476% of insured payroll with a 2-year rate guarantee. And our life insurance renewal has no increase, set at the same rate of 0.135 cents per $1,000 of provided coverage with a 2-year rate guarantee. So we just ask for your approval of those renewals at this time.
So from the disability, from the disability renewal, just so I'm clear, the reduction is a small reduction in benefit?
It's just a reduction in the premium cost. So there's no reduction in benefit. It's the same plan design that we have for long-term disability. But the rate that we pay based on payroll, because long-term disability, the cost is based on the eligible payroll, is calculated at that reduced premium rate. So there's no change to, there's no plan design change in either one of these situations, no benefit design changes. It maintains the existing policy with the existing coverage, just at a savings to the district. Probably about 4 or 5 years ago, our long-term disability rate was up over 0.8%. So we've really worked to negotiate those rates down. We've seen, again, positive claims utilization within this benefit, so we continue to move forward on that.
All right, any other questions regarding the life and long-term disability? If not, we can entertain a motion.
I move for the renewal of our long-term disability and life insurance.
A second.
So we have a motion by Ashmi and a second by Cole. Is there any discussion? All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed?
Chair votes aye. Motion carries.
Thank you.
So we can move on to item 60, which is donations.
Jumping into donations, just a quick restatement of that insurance, because while long conversation of insurance doesn't tend to excite me too much, 0% increase in premiums over multiple years and reductions of premiums means that the decisions made by these board members and previous board members and the decisions to remain healthy by our staff, who take a lot of preventative work in regard to their health, is actually leading to fiscal savings for both the district and also for the employees in an era where health insurance and life insurance costs typically go up all the time. In Richfield Public Schools, they actually do not. Well done.
Yeah, impressive.
Transitioning to donations, we got $3,336.06 from 2016 Take Charge of Education, a program through Target that donates 1% of Red Card purchases to the eligible K-12 designated school, and in this case, it's Sheridan Hills Elementary this month. And $100 from Evelyn Pickett to the Spartan Food Shelf. So we thank Target and Evelyn Pickett.
I would look for a motion that we accept these donations with gratitude.
So move.
Second.
So we have a motion by Ashmi and a second by Malik that we accept the donations with gratitude. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Any opposed? Chair votes aye. We are very grateful for these ongoing donations. The Achievement and Integration Budget.
Yes, thank you.
Great. Yeah.
So the Achievement and Integration Budget, given our timelines, it was due on March 15th. We did do a preliminary submission of that Achievement and Integration Budget pending board approval tonight. So it's been submitted, even though the deadline was March 15th. We are here and we did have permission from the Department of Ed to submit that late, given all of our staffing changes and program changes and things like that. We have about $1.2 million that's anticipated in our Achievement and Integration funding for next year. $1.172 million of that comes within the Achievement and Integration budget or funding, and then about $55,000 comes within the incentive aid funding. So it's two separate categories of funding that come from the Department of Ed. This budget follows a budget that is very similar to previous year's budgets as far as the services that are being provided as part of it. We reallocated some of the programming. If you're looking at detail, there are a couple pieces where within the template that the state provided, there were some numbers in the gray columns or that look at the funding for actual expenditures that just somehow leaked into those. So we're focused on the funding for the proposed budgeted amount, nothing in those areas that are gray or shaded at the top of the column. Within this, a minimum of 80% of the funding needs to be directed towards services to students. And then no more than 20% can be used for professional development, and no more than 10% can be used for administrative or indirect costs associated with the plan. So this plan has 81.63% allocated to those direct services to students. 17.79% of it is for professional development, with a high focus on providing that professional development around the Achievement and Integration programming within the district, with some outside resources that way. Much of this work goes towards social workers, counselors, our literacy interventionists, the direct service to students in those areas, trying to make sure that we're meeting the needs of our students who are with the greatest challenge, and then also within our outreach workers. Most of those positions are funded within this budget as well, improving communication with parents and families and students who are not native English speakers, to make sure those connections between the school and the families are grown and developed every year and are really functioning at a high level. The last page has the administrative costs. We do have Gallup provides a teacher insights survey or assessment tool that's part of our online teacher assessment program. Much of it was built and developed around the SRI perceivers' work in the urban teacher perceiver programming, and so there's a high cultural component to that that we use to make sure that we're trying to take out some of the personal biases a part of our screening process and look at individuals who score within ranges that are highly correlated to success. So that would be the small amount that's in that administrative cost of the program. So with that, we ask for your approval tonight for this budget. A written narrative plan is doesn't have to be submitted to the state until later on this spring.
Are there any questions for Craig around this Achievement and Integration budget?
I'll ask.
Yep.
The line item for professional development is $2,242. And so my question was, you know, that seemed lower to me than what we have maybe done in past years in terms of a specific line item for professional development. So can you speak to how the dollars were allocated this time around?
Yep. What we looked at was what are our known costs right now and where are we providing those services? So we know we have elementary, here it's written as elementary secondary, but it's our curriculum supports and our instructional practices staff that are here in the district. So trying to provide as much of our training as possible. So that's what we know right now. We don't have a specific plan of whether it's aligned with WEMAP or other programming. Certainly that frees up other resources for us to align into those areas.
Right, so to restate that and just to clarify, so what we did is we realigned our funds into the staffing that we know we have. Obviously to directly state, you know, Crystal has been spending an inordinate amount of time as our Joint Powers Board member of WEMAP and working through both a financial and a new instructional model package, and they are still kind of working out the details. As a reminder, we as a district have sent a withdrawal letter to WEMAP, which we can retain that withdrawal or we can retract. At this time, we functionally have not gotten enough information to make a full decision about our next steps with regard to WEMAP. So in that stead, what we did is staff members who do integration activities who may have been paid out of other pots of money are actually going to be planned for in the achievement and integration budget for next year, allowing us to utilize funds from those other pots of money for the professional development when we utilize it from whatever organization or however we go about that professional development. And this provides us a better timeline and a better set of opportunity to reflect prior to making some final decisions about what we want to do with our overall partnerships and our professional development funds.
I think that is a very wise strategy.
Thank you.
So I am sorry if I'm just being really dense on this. So the professional development total is $218,466.60. A significant portion of that is to fund four FTEs of equity coaches. Did I just restate what you said in a different way?
Yes. So basically, our instructional coaches. So previously, we might have seen $50,000 of professional development in our WEMAP partnership there. What you see there is instructional coaches in those line items. We know we have our instructional coaches. We know we are paying for our instructional coaches. So we are definitely planning for that. We have some ambiguity about WEMAP at this time. And so whereas those equity coaches may have been paid out of compensatory education, for example, we are now holding those funds that would have paid for them and waiting to see how some of that plays out. So we're still planning on doing equity professional development. We're still planning on continuing our overall focus, our overall vision, but we're utilizing sort of the timelines and the constrictions to make sure that when we send budgets into the state of Minnesota, there are things for known things that we're sure of. So we know the staff that are in here will be in those positions next year.
And just to clarify, there are only two positions that are included in that professional development. One of each one of those is salary and the other is benefits. So they're two separate line items. So it's not four positions, it's two positions.
All right, that clears up some stuff too,
because
I had a question on that.
So. Yep.
All right. Any other questions about this budget? If not, we can certainly entertain a motion.
I move we approve the budget as presented.
I'll second.
So we have a motion by Ashmead and a second by Brackey that we approve the achievement integration budget as presented. Is there any discussion on this item? All in favor, please say aye.
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 Any opposed? Chair votes aye. The budget is approved.
Thank you.
All right, we can move on to our, I think we got a legislative update coming up here.
Yes, and we have actually entered the legislative session. The governor has presented his preliminary budget, and the House and Senate are working with their pieces. And frankly, color me surprised. Within the governor's budget, as I recall back to our priorities, and it seemed like the entire state of Minnesota was talking about working with special education funding and talking about reducing the cross-subsidy, mysteriously missing from any presentation at this time is anything having to do with that. It would appear that priorities have focused around funding for teacher licensure and ensuring that there are more pathways and more abilities to fund teacher licensing. It would appear that current priorities have gone around pre-K scholarships or continuing to expand options for students to be in high quality four-year-old and pre-K programs. And then also a new program to match mental health positions. So counselors and social workers match dollar for dollar is also part of, and it's an expansion of positions, are matched dollar for dollar. However, there is not necessarily full alignment to some of the things we had prioritized. Pre-K funding does align to some of our pre-K piece, but along with AMSD and along with the Minnesota School Boards Association, there was a lot of work looking at funding in regard to special education, which is not currently in a bill of the legislative perspective at this time.
So, yeah, so I mean, just reflecting back on our meeting with our legislators, that pre-K piece certainly comes up, and I think that at the time, at least, we had sort of given the message to our legislators that something was better than nothing, so I suppose we can't, beggars can't be choosers in that scenario. But we may want to take the opportunity to contact our legislators around special ed support for special, reducing that special ed cross subsidy. And that is a substantial priority. Are there information and questions from the board regarding any liaison assignments or other activities?
With our joint meeting with City Council next month, the combined Bloomington Richfield Community Ed group met at one of the activity centers at Bloomington, one at each high school. Very impressive. And it's a citywide effort, although it was funded through school bonding. But I know years ago there was talk of a community center, activity center here in Richfield. I haven't heard who about it in recent years. Is that something that we could put on the agenda as a, just to see if there's any interest in it, talk about it, where it's at?
Yeah. I mean, I think you're right that there is history on that. I think quite a bit of history, as a matter of fact. I believe this predates that the, was there an actual referendum question? I can't recall if that actually went to the voters that may predate our current mayor.
I think you're right. I think it did. It was defeated. But both of these activity centers are just impressive structure for facilities, I should say.
Yeah.
Yeah. And there's two of them in Bloomington. I realize Bloomington's twice as big as we are. Anyway, it was interesting.
It'd be interesting to hear from the city, you know, if there's been any more thoughts around that. We actually went back in 2004 when we talked about our facility study plan. They had even wondered about the central site as a possible joint site for doing something. That was just all pie in the sky at the time.
I was going to say, there is some information from that 2003-2005 study about exploring that opportunity as a joint funding partnership between the city and the school district.
Okay.
So we have some information that you could access just for historical information.
And we can absolutely add that to the conversation piece of part of our agenda.
So very good. So that does bring us to our next item, which is just talking about future meeting dates. We will be meeting next on Monday, the 4th of April. Our regular meeting here at 7, that is preceded at 6 by the study session with the City Council. In addition to the item that Mr. Ashman has just mentioned, we will also be talking about affordable housing, technology graduation rates, and test results. So I think we'll have plenty to fill an hour. Our second meeting in April is Monday the 18th. That is here at the district boardroom at 7 o'clock. It will be hosted by Richfield Dual Language School. Are there any suggested agenda items?
I think we had talked about and had an email inquiries from board about a study session examining WEMAP partnership and also 287 partnership. And so it may be a good opportunity at one of our meetings in May to get together, especially since we'll be examining before long whether or not we want to maintain our course in terms of withdrawing from WEMAP. So I would suggest that we have a study session at one of our two meetings in May to talk both about WEMAP and about 287 to make sure we all have a large picture of the services and what those partnerships bring us.
What do members think about the first meeting in May as a date for a study session? Would there be any opposition to that date? Anybody who knows they won't be here?
And that would be May 2nd.
Can we do it a second meeting though? Because I'm going to be a bit engaged.
You know, is that
beginning
right?
Of April, I mean May.
You know, is that
so
right?
So might give me a couple more weeks to be able to leave the house without a tail.
Well, we could do the second meeting. I would be open to that. I don't know that we're under necessarily under any other time constraint.
Nope.
You're gonna bring your friends though along, right?
The one thing I would say too, as Superintendent mentioned, I've been spending a lot of time with WEMAP, and so if people do have any individual questions about what WEMAP is working on and the different plans that have been discussed, feel free to get in touch with me if you want to chat about that between now and our discussion in May.
All right. So I think that'll be good. We'll get that on the calendar for the second meeting in May. And right, you can't go over, right? There's no way that's happening. Okay, good.
I wanted to, but no.
Sure.
There's okay. A timeline apparently.
Yes. Yeah, gotcha. All right. Any other items for the agenda? We can look at a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Second.
A motion by Pauls and second by Malik that we adjourn. All in favor, please say aye.
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 Chair votes aye. We are adjourned.